so why is it that when people, you start a brand on social media, right? All these individuals try to build you up and try to break you down. What is wrong with people's mentality these days?
I think that people be just envious and jealous.
Oh.
And they think that it's not enough out here for all of us.
Wow.
And so they feel like, you know, we have that crab in a bucket mentality, especially in the black community.
Yeah.
So Boniface Ogunti can't make money if I could make money. So I got to tear Boniface down. Wow. So I could exceed, so I could succeed. So a lot of people don't understand that it's enough for me, it's enough for you, it's enough for everybody.
Yeah.
And I truly believe that, you know, collaboration is the new currency. So we're better together than apart. I look good sitting here with you. You look good sitting here with me.
100%.
I don't have to tear down your business to build my business up.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, the more I validate your business, the more I help to transition the minds of the people by letting them know that you could be a black man, young, successful, and being a mentor and supporting other people. So we just got to have a mindset shift. That's what I think we got to do.
That's true.
Help people to change their mindset.
So take us back. You've done $50 million in the last 8 years.
9 years.
In the last 9 years.
Mm-hmm.
How?
So I am in that industry that people think is a pyramid. It's a scam. Like I do e-commerce kind of like you.
Yeah.
But I do e-commerce kind of like on steroids. So not only.
Explain.
Let me explain. Okay. So multi-level marketing is e-commerce, depending on the company. So my company is multi-level marketing.
So isn't multi-level marketing like basically when a person makes money off another person? So you guys utilize the multi-level marketing formula with selling physical product.
Exactly. So the difference, and let me give you an example, right?
Okay.
So you do e-commerce, right?
Yeah.
And you have students, right? So imagine if every student you've had, how many students you've had in the last 5 years?
Over 10,000.
So imagine if those students were part of your lineage.
Yeah.
And every time they grew as an e-commerce or a salesperson, imagine if you earned a percentage of all their income. So of course you may earn money when they pay you to be a coach and a mentor or join your program.
Yeah.
But me, their success is directly tied to my income.
Wow.
So it's kind of like I like to marry my business partners. I don't like to one night stand them and romance them.
Mm-hmm.
Because the more money I help my business partners make, the more money I make. So it's a different level of accountability, a different level of love, a different level of support.
Yeah.
Because the more money I help you make in multi-level marketing, the more money I make. So it's really like a personal development company with a compensation plan tied to amazing products.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying?
100%.
So I get to make overrides off of their growth.
Wow.
So I need them to grow. I need them to win. They can't just pay me for a mentorship or pay me for a program.
Yeah.
No, I need to keep you in the business long enough so that you can win and I could consistently make residual passive income off of you hitting your goals. It's a different mindset that a lot of people in our community are not aware of.
Yeah.
But it's been around forever.
Yeah.
The white folk, the Asian
folks.
What
made you get into network marketing? Like there's so many other opportunities that you could have pursued.
Yeah. So
why network marketing?
Okay, so picture this. I've been in network marketing for 15 years.
Yeah.
And when I first got started, I was a little broke, fat, uneducated. I dropped out of school in the ninth grade.
Yeah.
I used to be a stripper. I used to do scams for a living.
Wow.
So I didn't have the knowledge on how to start as an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
So I actually got into network marketing like 15 years ago just to make some extra income. Many people don't know this, but I used to be a TSA agent. I used to wear the little ugly uniforms and check your bags.
Wow.
I used to work at customer service. I used to be the one to call you and say, hey, you need to pay your Sprint bill, you know? And so when I first got into network marketing, I got in because it was easy entry.
Yeah.
It don't cost, my first company I started with $250.
Wow.
You don't have to have a lot of skills. You know, you are in business for yourself, but you're not by yourself.
Yeah.
And so multi-level marketing gives you a lot of support.
Yeah.
And so if I would have started a traditional business, I would have had to try to find a coach, I had to try to find a mentor, try to find an investment to start the business.
That's true.
But multi-level marketing, $200 gets me all of that and product.
I remember when I first got into the whole entrepreneurship space, the first thing I wanted to do was actually network multi-level marketing. But I always had this notion, I was like, man, I don't want to do multi-level marketing. I always had this misconception because it was like, you make money off of this person and this person. I feel like, oh, I'm building this other person business. You know, I wanted to create my own product and sell my own product instead of me trying to build this other person organization. What do you think about that? And people who have that misconception about them actually building it, working in a company instead of them trying to do it by themselves.
You want me to tell you the truth?
Tell me.
I think people perish for lack of knowledge.
Mm.
I don't know your income and I don't know who's watching what their income is, right? Yeah. But I've earned take home in my bank account in 9 years in one company, $50 million plus dollars.
Yeah.
Right?
Yep.
And I started with $1,000.
Yeah.
My business overhead to run my multi-level marketing company every month, Boniface, is $150. My biggest overhead comes from my traditional business because I was trying to, you know, it's kind of like we got to be careful with imposter syndrome, right?
Yeah.
I'm in multi-level marketing, but it has a black eye. Sometime, you know, prior to like right now, I just got into a place where I'm owning my shit again.
Yeah.
I'm a network marketer.
Yeah.
I have a skincare line. That shit ain't making me no money.
Yeah.
I got a CBD line. I'm not making no money. I got a yacht. I don't rent my yacht out. I own my yacht. I'm not renting my yacht out.
Exactly.
I have an office. I paid 19, 20 grand a month for my office.
Yeah.
I don't need none of that with my network marketing company. All I got to do is invest $150 a month. So a lot of people don't understand the difference. If people really understood what network marketing is, they would be in it. It's too easy. I got one leg of business that makes me $100,000 in a month. Wow. My biggest week in my current company was like $500,000. My biggest month was $3 million, and I only invested $150.
Wow.
So people don't have the right information, and I'm starting today. Like you don't understand. Like, you know how you wake up different?
Yeah.
Today's the day I woke up different. I woke up mad, motivated, and determined.
Yeah.
And I'm about to make sure people put some respect on my name, but put some respect on this industry. Because if I didn't have a person like me that inspired me, because it was a woman that looked like me that made me realize I can do it.
Yeah.
The more success stories we have that look like us, they got the swag like us, they got the vibe like us, the more people that come from where we come from will believe that if we could do it, that they can do it too.
That's true.
So I just been quiet for too long, and so you got me on a real good day.
I'm glad we got you on here. I'm glad we got you on here. You know, I want to know what's your real motivation?
Freedom.
You know?
Freedom.
Let's talk about your motivation when you first got started. Like, what gave you that hunger? And that drive, you're just like, man, I'm gonna do whatever it takes to achieve my goals. Cause you said something, and I think that's something we have in common too. You said you was gonna get rich or die trying.
Period.
When I was starting my business, I said I was gonna get rich or die trying, and there was no excuse.
Yeah.
It's either I was gonna create it or I was gonna create it.
Exactly.
There's no anything else. I'm doing it, and I'm gonna achieve this goal. And I saw that from you on one of your interviews. So what was that real motivation you had when you first got started?
I was tired of being tired. I was tired of telling my kids no. I have 3 kids.
Yeah.
From 3 different men.
Yeah.
I tried the man take care of me thing.
Yeah.
I had 3 kids trying. It didn't work out.
Wow.
I didn't graduate from high school. I didn't go to college. And I didn't like what it felt like being ordinary and average.
Yeah.
Like, I've been rich and I've been poor, and I think rich is better.
Yep.
And so when I first actually got started, it was because I was just tired, like for real. And, you know, I don't know who needs to hear this, but my mom used to say, I'm tired, I'm tired. And guess what? She died.
Yeah.
She was speaking that into her life. She was so tired, she went to sleep.
Yeah.
And so I was in a space where I realized that I didn't have the education. I thought that, you know, you had to be super smart.
Yeah.
Until I read Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill and Dennis Kimbrough. And I learned that you could think and grow rich. It's not I will, it's IQ.
Yeah.
It's not IQ, it's I will.
Yeah.
Excuse me. It's not IQ, it's I will.
Yeah.
And so when I started to realize that, wait a minute, people are successful in the world.
Yeah.
What's the difference from those that succeed and those that don't succeed?
Yeah.
It's perspective, it's decision, and it's belief.
Yeah.
And so I just got so sick and tired of being sick and tired. I used to be on Section 8. I used to have a Section 8 voucher.
Wow.
I used to be on food stamps.
Wow.
I used to be on WIC. I used to be on Medicaid. I had all 3 of my kids on Medicaid. You understand?
Wow.
I delivered my children with Medicaid.
That's insane.
My first 2 kids, I had them on Section 8, living in Section 8. My first 2 kids, I had them on food stamps.
Yeah.
But I just got tired and I wanted more. And I knew that the only way I'm going to get more is if I go and get more.
Yep.
Ain't nobody going to give it to me. I got to go get it.
So, Stormy, how do you streamline your time? You know, because a lot of people like me, right? I don't cook, I don't do anything because I feel like if I'm doing any of those things, it's taking away me focusing on my business. So how do you streamline your time by letting people know that? Because a lot of people don't realize that if they're focused on so many different things going on, it's going to be hard for them to focus on their business. So what do you have to say about that?
So, first of all, it takes time to get to that place. I think that some people are so busy trying to move too quick, too fast, too soon. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you got to do everything until you could afford it.
Yeah.
So I will tell people that's watching this interview, don't have the misconception of you got to have a whole staff and you got to have all this stuff that I'm about to tell you.
Yeah.
Because for years, I'm the one that, and I had this conversation with my operation director today.
Yeah.
I'm the one who was the visionary behind my banners, my website. I did my training calls. I did my three-way calls. I did my home parties. I'm the one who used to set up my own hotels. I'm the one that used to book the hotels. I'm the one who used to promote. I'm the visionary behind everything. I don't have a staff or a CFO or a CMO. I'm the visionary behind everything.
I think that's pretty required. Like, when you're first starting out, you got to be the person that's doing everything.
I did everything, but I did everything up to, like, $5 million.
Yep, and that's what made you master your craft. A lot of entrepreneurs are trying to become entrepreneurs and they want to hire so many people right away and they haven't even mastered their craft yet.
There you go. There you go. So, of course, when I got to a place when I realized that if it cost me, let's say, a $500 a week employee or a $1,000 a week employee, I have to take account of my time.
Yeah.
Where am I best served? Yeah. So right now I have a full-time housekeeper. She comes to my house every day except Sunday.
Yeah.
And I promise you, it's like God gives me that experience on Sunday to remind me, I don't care what you got going on, you ain't got time to be making up no beds.
Yeah.
So I have a full-time housekeeper. I have a full-time driver.
Yeah.
Every time I drive on my own, I'm reminded again, I'm texting and driving. I'm trying to be on a conference call and drive. So I have a full-time driver. I had a full-time chef until my family said they want me to cook, but I still don't have time to cook. So I don't cook. My dad cooks.
Yeah.
I pay my dad every week to make sure he goes to the grocery store for us. My dad cooks. If I cook, it's like a love offering. So I may cook once every 3 months, but my dad is the one responsible for making sure we eat. And again, it's not me trying to, you know, pop my collar or nothing.
Yeah, but that I'm allows better, you to focus.
Yeah, I'm better working. If I have to, again, I had this conversation today.
Yeah.
If I gotta be the one ordering the banners.
Yeah.
If I gotta be the one checking the verbiage on the website.
Yeah.
If I gotta be the one checking how many tickets we sold, you guys are not allowing me to be best suited. Like Mark Zuckerberg said, I only do things that I do best.
Yeah.
And I hire people to do the rest.
That's true.
So I have to get back to that. Like I'm not even there right now. Like I'm really regrouping majorly because I'm best suited connecting with people. Like my time should be spent sitting, talking to people like you.
Yeah.
My time should be spent talking to people in my business that can produce and bear fruit.
Yeah.
So it's a timing thing and it's understanding your worth. There was a time where I was making $100,000 a day.
Yeah.
$200,000 a day.
Yeah.
You know, one thing about me, I'm transparent. I'm not there right now.
Yeah.
And it's because I allow people that used to be able to take responsibility for certain things, I allow them to get comfortable. And so a lot of balls have started to drop. Mm. And I even got comfortable. You know
what
I mean?
Why do you feel like you got comfortable?
My house is paid off. I'm millions of dollars in the bank. I'm making $2-3 million a month. Sometimes you think it's going to keep coming in.
Yeah.
And then you also get tired sometimes. Sometimes as an entrepreneur, you get burned out. I just want to chill for a little bit.
Yeah.
But a little bit turned into a long time. You see what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
And now it's time for me to get back in my bag. Like, you know, I'm used to making $1 million a month.
Yeah.
And I'm not there right now. But I'm grateful because I've done it several times over.
Yeah.
And so now I'm regrouping, I'm recalibrating, I'm recalculating, I'm reformulating, and I'm handling my business. And then the next 90 days to 6 months is going to be a different story. So even when we first came in and had a conversation, I'm like, who are you? Who are you? Who are you? Because I'm looking for certain people to do certain things that I don't have the capacity to do.
Yeah, 100%. So let's talk about obsession, because I think obsession is overlooked and is never talked about. For you to have any level of success in your life, you have to be obsessed. There's people out there who are trying to become a multimillionaire, but they're not obsessed.
Mm. I'm obsessed and I'm possessed. Mm-hmm. You know, people get demon possessed.
Yeah.
I'm multimillionaire, transformation, millionaire maker possessed.
Yeah.
Like I don't feel good. You know, one of my favorite books is The Ma'at.
Okay.
And I'm an energy person, so I'll grab a book and I'll just turn to a random page and I know my energy attracted it.
Yeah.
So last week, you know, I turned to a page in The Ma'at and it said, your greatest success comes when your worth is tied to your works. If I'm not working, I feel worthless.
Exactly.
I don't want to chill.
Yep.
I don't want to go to the mall every day.
Yep.
I don't want to go to Bell Harbor every day. I don't want to go jewelry shopping every day. I want to work. Yep. I want to transform lives. I want to meet amazing people. I want to transform people mentally. And so I'm very obsessed, and I'm also possessed too.
That's amazing. That's amazing. That's amazing. So the question I want to ask you is that, you know, a lot of people, what's your daily routine? Because, like, a lot of people want to know a multi-millionaire daily routine.
That's good. So first of all, I would tell you, I could curse?
Go ahead.
Okay, all that bullshit about you got to wake up at 5 o'clock in the morning, that's not true.
Yeah.
So one of the number one reasons why I became an entrepreneur is because I don't like waking up super early.
Yeah.
And if I do wake up, I want to lay in my bed until I'm ready to get out of my bed.
Yeah.
So my body naturally wakes up about 6 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah.
But I'm not out of my bed.
Yeah.
I wake up.
What time do you get out of your bed? Do you do a lot of work in bed?
So I'm going to tell you. So I wake up at about 6.
Yeah.
I talk to my Ori, which is your first spiritual being, which is your mind.
Yeah.
I talk to myself. I check in with myself. I ask myself, how am I feeling? Like, Stormy, how do you feel today?
Yeah.
And I'm real with myself.
Yeah.
I don't feel good today. I'm discouraged today. I'm pissed off today. I'm motivated and determined today. I'm sad today. I'm depressed today. So I check in with myself, and I allow myself to acknowledge and accept how I feel. Mm-hmm. Number one.
Yeah.
I say a special prayer to myself every morning.
Wow.
After that, I clap my hands. I open up my blinds. Sometimes some people see it on social media. I open up my blinds. It's like, that's like the highlight of my morning. Like, I love watching my blinds hit the remote control and it just opens up. It's like, how blessed am I to have blinds that I could push a button and they open.
Facts.
So it's like my gratitude moment. Like, bitch, you got blinds, baby.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You ain't got verticals, you know.
Yeah.
You ain't got no thing that you got a blind, you got to pull.
Yeah.
Baby, you push the button, baby.
Yeah.
So that's my gratitude moment. And then I meditate every morning. Every morning, I go into meditation, but I have a group that I meditate with. And so sometimes I do it by myself. I also do personal development. I don't get out of my bed until I've learned something new. So every morning when I wake up, I turn to something on YouTube and I listen to it. Or I love Audible. I'm reading this book right now called The Untethered Soul. It's so good. You ever heard of that book?
No, I've never.
Oh my gosh. So I'm listening to The Untethered Soul right now. I love Abraham Hicks.
Okay, yeah, I know.
You know Abraham Hicks. Yeah. I love Abraham Hicks. You know, I love Les Brown. I love Stormy Wallerton.
Yeah.
I love the Ma'at. So I do personal development early in the morning, and then I go into meditation. After meditation, I take my supplements. I take amazing weight loss and energy supplements. I take my NRG pills in the morning.
Yeah.
Gives me focus, makes me feel happy, you know, curbs my appetite, you know.
Yeah.
Like, what time is it? 3:30. I haven't had no food yet.
Wow.
I'm not saying it's good, but I take some supplements that allow me to, I got you, girl. So I have these supplements I take in the morning. It gives me focus. It makes me feel happy. It makes me want to talk. That's why I'm talking so much to you. I just had it in the car.
Yeah.
And I take my NutriBurst in the morning. After meditation, then I drink this special coffee. I drink my coffee. And then I love to move my body, you know. You know, the best part of waking up is not Folgers in my cup. I take my NRG. I drink it with my coffee.
Yeah.
And after that, I put on my workout clothes. Before I go work out, I go into my special prayer room and I go handle my prayer business again. My second probably prayer for the day. Oh, I take showers every morning.
Yeah.
Every morning before I put on my workout clothes.
Yeah.
And after I put on my workout clothes, I go either for a long walk.
Yeah.
Or I go to box or Pilates or to go with my trainer. Some way, somehow I'm gonna get it in. And I really, truthfully, don't like to be bothered before 12.
Yeah.
If I could have it my way, like, and if I let you talk to me before 12, you somebody special, because I love to own my mornings. I call them billion-dollar mornings.
Yeah.
After that, you know, I'm working. Like, I'm ready to work. I'm ready to talk on the phone. You know, I like to see what's going on in my business. I like to, okay, what are we doing today?
Yeah.
And I'm focused. And my business is my life.
Yeah.
And I love it. So I'm working really all day. And my days are about me talking to people, connecting with people, giving people insight, educating people, giving them tips and strategies and helping them to understand certain things that they probably didn't understand before.
Yeah.
And I do that pretty much until it's time to go to bed.
Wow.
And then I wake up the next day and I do it all again.
Wow. That's insane. And that's a really, really great schedule. That's a really, really great schedule.
For
that's
sure.
A really, really great schedule. So what I got so much. So you said Rick Ross like inspired you to stop thinking small. How did he inspire you?
I mean, so many ways. First of all, Rick Ross comes from Miami Care City. Yeah. You know, Rick Ross started from the bottom. You know, yeah. He came from the bottom. Rick Ross was a correctional officer and, you know, saw something more for himself and mm-hmm. became a rapper and hung around the right people. And when I said that he inspired me today specifically, I was thinking about when you sit down with Rick Ross,
yeah,
he gonna bring his bottle of Bel Air.
Yeah.
He gonna bring his rap snacks.
Yeah.
And he gonna sit him on a table.
Yeah.
And you gotta respect that he gonna sit him on a table.
Yeah,
that's something that a lot of us don't do. We are ashamed of promotion, or we don't want to feel like we're being disrespectful. But Rick Ross, like, nah, you want me on your chair? I need to get some money. I need people to know what I'm doing.
Of course.
And those are some of the things that I kind of stopped doing. I would sit on somebody in somebody's chair, talk to somebody, and not give them no samples. Like, before I leave here, you and your boo gonna get some products. I'm gonna teach you how to make it.
Yeah.
I'm gonna tell you to use it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like those, that's what I do.
Yeah.
And so Rick Ross reminded me of that. You know, right now I still fly commercial.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I don't like it. Yeah. I really want to go on a tour. I would love to be in 3 different cities.
Yeah.
But back in my bed that night, I can't do that on Delta First Class. I don't care if I'm a Delta Diamond.
Yeah.
Rick Ross got a plane. Why Stormy Wellington ain't got no plane?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I'm inspired by his work ethic. I'm inspired by how he doesn't have an issue with teaching and educating and elevating our people.
Yep.
And you know, let me tell you something that happened. I went to the Promised Land, his house one day, right? He had something at his house. And this helped me, this blessed me. So they called whoever they needed to call, and they were like, Stormy Wellington is at the gate, and she has like 4 people with her.
Yeah.
And they go, well, hold on. They came back and they say, how many people she have with her? Stormy Wellington is at the gate. She got a security, she got some person with her, and she got like her camera guy and one more girl. And they go, well, she could come in, but the staff can't come. The people with her, they can't come.
Wow.
And that hit me. Let me tell you why it hit me.
Wow.
Because if I was who I feel like I am, if I was respected, like I feel like I'm supposed to be respected, whoever I bring is supposed to be welcome. You know, you think they're gonna tell Beyonce, only you could come, Beyonce? No.
Nah.
So in that moment, I realized that I got more work to do. Keep working until you get respected. Keep working until you get noticed.
Always.
Yeah, and so those are the things that he did for me.
Wow, he really increased your standards more.
Oh, for sure. That's what we do around each other.
Yeah.
I'm increasing my standards right now talking to you.
Yeah.
Looking at your team and everything, I'm like, okay, let me step my game up.
That's awesome. So I wanna go into your story more in details, because there's a lot of entrepreneurs who are watching this podcast right now. They don't realize like the work that you put into building your business. And you put a lot of work into this. It didn't just appear to you. I see a lot of entrepreneurs who want to start businesses and they quit on themselves.
Yeah.
They started for a month.
Yeah.
And then they give up.
Yeah.
What do you have to say for those people?
I mean, everything big.
Yeah.
On the biggest podcast.
Yeah.
Everything big was once small.
Yeah.
We got to know that. Everybody had a day one.
Yeah.
Everybody had a day when they didn't know, a week, a year, 2, 3 years.
Yeah.
Everybody dealt with insecurities as entrepreneurs.
Yeah.
Even when you become successful, you still may fall into the trap of being insecure or questioning yourself.
Yeah.
And so it just gets to a place that you gotta work harder on yourself than you do anything else. And you gotta understand that it's a numbers game.
Yeah.
Like, you what if you like right there?
Yeah.
3 feet from goal. What if you right there and you quit the day before you was going to be interviewed by Boniface?
Yeah.
You know how long I've been knowing you and watching you? I think if you go through the inbox, I done DM'd like you before about a lot of things. And you was like, yeah, whatever.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And I'm a big deal and you a big deal.
Yeah.
But there was the respect level, however, was not there.
Yeah.
So keep working until you get noticed. Just know that everybody has to go through their season. Everybody has to go through their period of learning, of trying to figure things out. And then make sure you really want this.
Yeah.
Because once you get it, now you gotta keep reinventing yourself. You gotta keep elevating yourself. Yep. It's like, it's a marriage, you know, with no infidelity. Yeah. You know, it's like, don't leave. Don't divorce your dreams and your goals. And so people just gotta know, like, if you really, really want it, don't quit. Keep going until you get to that end result, whatever the end result may be. And when you get there, start all over again with a new one.
Yep. How do you find your superpower?
How do I find my superpower?
Like, when you're being by yourself, do you, like me, when I'm by myself, that's how I find my superpower.
So, no, I'm not by myself a lot.
Yeah.
I find my superpower by speaking affirmations.
Yeah.
By speaking to myself. Like, I talk to myself a lot.
Yeah.
You know, I remind myself of who I am by conversation. I look at my bank account.
Yeah.
If my bank account is not looking the way I need it to look, that's how I keep myself motivated and going. You know, I ain't a billionaire yet. I can't chill
yet.
You
will be.
Yeah, I can't chill yet. I got work to do. Yeah. So I'm motivated by the story. And also, I know it's the people that want to see me fail. I know there's people right now that want to see me quit. They want to see me fail. They holding their nuts. They holding their fingers. And they need to cross them. They won't. So I know that. I use it as fuel.
Yeah.
Picture me falling off. You know how many people would be satisfied right now?
Yeah.
So I'm like, I'm not going to let that happen. And so that inspires me. The knowingness that there's people out there that want to see me fall off. They want to see me go from a black badge coloring. No disrespect, ain't nothing wrong with a Honda because I had one of them too.
Yeah.
But they want to see me go from my black badge to a Honda talking about I'm just living a minimalistic life. No. Yeah. It's from the Cullinan to another Cullinan.
Yeah.
From the Cullinan to a private plane.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So
it's
that
always up.
It's always up. There's always another level with your name on it. And I'm never getting comfortable. And if I do get comfortable, I'm going to shake it off after a little bit. I ain't going to stay comfortable too long.
Yeah. So let's talk about your products, right? What inspired you to want to actually do these products?
So I come from a family of obese women.
Okay.
My mom died at about 61. She was 61 years old. She was about to turn 62. I was holding her hand.
Yeah.
She died August 26th of 2011. I thought my mom was having an anxiety attack. She was actually dying. And her birthday was September 29th.
Wow.
She'd kill herself. Nobody want to accept the fact that eating wrong, you know, not taking care of your health, your mental health, your emotional health,
yeah,
is killing yourself. You can make up every excuse in the world and hereditary and all that stuff. Everything that we do to ourselves is either giving us life or giving us death.
That's true.
And so I realized that, okay, I was 40 pounds heavier.
Yeah.
I looked like I was 43 20 years ago.
Wow.
And I'm 43 today.
Wow.
I look older 20 years ago than I do now.
Yeah.
And so I tried the product. I heard I could make all this money. I thought it was, excuse me, bullshit.
Yeah.
I used to have a condition called IBS. A lot of women don't use the bathroom like they're supposed to. And a lot of men, a lot of people really full of shit. Yeah. You get me? And so I was told that these products can help me to cleanse my system and give me energy and mental clarity. And that's another thing I tell y'all watching this. Stop talking about your product and give people an experience.
Yep.
So I heard all about it. I'm like, yeah, whatever. Sales strategy. Bullshit. That shit don't work.
Yeah.
But I got on the product before I ever got into business. And it worked.
Yeah.
I ended up losing like 10 pounds in 10 days. I gave it to my sister. My sister ended up like losing like 30 pounds in 30 days.
Wow.
One of my girlfriends ended up losing like 20 pounds in 21 days from the product alone. And I'm like, I could sell this.
Yeah.
How many people need this? And so it started with me just having an experience and seeing the value behind the product and the simplicity of selling a product that works. Like, I don't sell my product and I'm afraid. I could give you a product right now. I'm going to give your wife some product. And I know tomorrow she's going to be like, wait a minute, let me call her. This is crazy. The way I feel, it's crazy. What's happening to me is crazy. What's in the toilet is crazy.
Yeah.
So I like to sell things that I can stand behind and that I believe in.
Wow. And that's the only way to do business. Always make sure you stand behind things that you can be proud of.
Yep, exactly.
So let's talk about relationship.
Yeah.
You're actually, you have a partner right now.
Yeah, how you know?
I mean, I think Instagram.
I'm just asking. Is it obvious? Because I don't know. I'm asking. Okay, yes,
Instagram.
I do.
So like super successful. How was it like when you was dating different men and stuff like that, trying to find that partner that you have today?
First of all, I would tell you, one of the things I learned is that we as women, we successful or not successful, we got to have some standards.
Yeah.
And we have to have real clarity on what we want in a man.
Yeah.
But we also have to have clarity on what we're willing to give. And so for a long time, you know, I was picking the wrong men, but I didn't really have a standard. And I really didn't have certain things that I looked for in terms of my value proposition.
Yeah.
And so finally this time,
yeah.
Finally.
What was your standards though? Like, did he have to make a certain type of income? Like, would you date a guy, $50 million you have done. Would you date a guy who makes $1 million a year, $10 million?
Yeah.
So you'll date a guy that makes $1 million, six figures?
Yeah.
How about a guy that works a job?
No.
Okay.
I'm not dating a guy that works a job, but let me tell you why though.
Yeah.
First of all, like, so here's my criteria, okay?
Yeah.
It's called Chris.
Okay.
C-H-R-I-S. my man had to have Chris. I didn't know this last year. Like, I just learned this, okay? Yeah. So don't, you know, yeah. don't get me on this one, right? You're like, wait, the other guy ain't have Chris? No. Chris, I needed to come up with an acronym to remind myself of what I'm looking for.
Yeah.
What does that mean? Number one, I need a man that cares enough about himself that he has good credit.
Yeah.
What's up with your credit?
Yeah.
That's important.
Yep, that's true.
Right? The second thing is, does he care about his health? I realized through the trials and tribulations,
yeah,
no disrespect, but I can't date a guy that's fat.
Yeah.
I can't get to date a guy that got a big old stomach and can't hardly breathe walking up the stairs and doesn't care about his health.
That's true.
I didn't know that before. I used to date you. But after having all of these errors and all these mistakes, or shall I say blessings in the form of lessons,
yeah,
I realized that this was what was going wrong. The R is real estate. What do I mean by real estate? These men sometimes don't even have nowhere to live.
Wow.
Don't laugh, sis.
That's crazy.
I'm not dating a man that don't have his own house.
Wow.
Like, you cannot live with your homeboy. You can't live with your kids. You can't be in between houses and you living in a hotel or you renting an Airbnb. It's like, come on now.
Yeah.
I didn't know this though.
Yeah.
So he need to have a place.
Yeah.
Okay. Wow. The I is investment.
Yeah.
He can't have a job. It doesn't work. First of all, I need him to have time. Yeah. I don't need him. I got to call you back. My boss coming.
Yeah.
I can't go. I don't know if I can get the days off. Hey, my lunch break is up. I'm going to call you back.
Yeah.
No, it's not going to work.
It won't work.
And then the S is,
different worlds.
The S is support. My guy has to have a support system.
Yeah.
I've dated guys that don't have no friends.
Wow.
And I didn't know that that's a problem. Something is wrong if you're dating a man that don't have no friends.
That's crazy.
You ain't got no mentor.
Wow.
You ain't got no coach. So you just take advice from yourself. So these are the things that I had to learn. And so now I got values, I got standards, and my man got Chris.
Yeah.
His name could be Chris. I had to learn the hard way, but I got it now. Woo!
So when it comes to business, right, we see people on social media all the time saying negative stuff and stuff like that. How do you control your emotion and reaction with people trying to say, oh, Stormy Wellington's a scammer and things like that? How do you control your emotion and reaction towards those things?
Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. They don't know me. How am I going to let somebody on social media that don't know me? You are a computer. How am I going to argue with a computer?
Exactly.
How am I going to allow someone that's sitting behind a computer that don't know me to tell me who I am?
Exactly.
That's like dumb.
Yeah.
Like, even I read comments, yeah, but it's fun.
It's funny.
I'm like, exactly. Damn, for real? You think that of me? Damn, I'm that? You know, like, I don't let a computer. You don't even know if it's a man or a woman. Just because the profile picture is a woman, yeah, don't mean it's a woman. It could be a man.
Behind it.
And just because the profile picture is a man, don't mean it's a man. It could be a woman.
Yeah.
So why would I let somebody behind a computer affect me? However, that wasn't always my truth. There was a time where I would go crazy. Yeah. I mean, 2000 and I think 19, they tried to, I got canceled. Remember that? I don't know if you remember. Oh, I got big time canceled. Like, I never experienced nothing like that in my life.
Like, what do you mean canceled? Like,
remember during the George Floyd situation? You didn't remember what happened to me during that?
Nah, I don't remember.
Oh, I was canceled. They canceled
me. Like, what's canceled? Like, what is that?
So let me tell you.
How do you cancel someone?
So, for real, let me tell you. So I don't remember what year this was, but and you're going to understand this. Like, we live in this, like, bubble.
Yeah.
Like, you don't be knowing certain things. Like, you live in your world.
Yeah.
And only way you know what's going on in the world is if somebody tells you, right?
Yeah.
Like, people like us, we're not watching the news.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not trying to be rude and funny. I'm compassionate. I'm saddened behind what's going on in the Palestinians, but I really don't know.
You don't know that because it's not in your world.
No, I really don't know.
Yeah.
And of course, people will probably feel like that's so insensitive.
Yeah.
I don't know
what's going
so
on.
I can't address it. I can't give you my opinion. All I could tell you is that's fucked up that these people are losing their lives, children. That's all I could tell you.
Yeah.
But please don't ask me no other questions. You understand?
Yep.
So when George Floyd got murdered, right, at the time, I really did not know. Like, for real, I never saw the video with the man with his foot on the neck.
I didn't know, too.
Okay, so guess what I did?
Yeah, I didn't know.
So I didn't know.
Yeah.
So anyway, I'm working. I'm doing. Yeah. I'm booming at this point. Yeah. Like I'm making like $100,000 a day.
Yeah.
Like $150,000 a day. Like, yeah. Ooh. Yeah. And guess what happened? They do the blackout. You don't remember that day?
Everybody posted a black picture on their Instagram?
There you go.
Oh, that day. Oh, I didn't like that day. I lost a lot of money that day.
Stop. So guess what I did?
What?
The blackout comes. And my team is like, coach, don't go live. Post black. We're not working today.
Yeah.
Real talk, brother face. I'm making $100,000 to $150,000 a day.
Yeah.
If we don't work, if we ain't on social media, business is gonna slow down.
Yeah.
So people really calling me like, coach, what do? We can't work today. I'm like, what you mean? It's the blackout. I'm like, the blackout? I'm literally preparing to do a launch call. There's 300 people on the call excited because my business is popping.
Yeah.
I shoot a video because I got tired of the text messages. Coach, what should we do? Like, I'm a leader. I'm responsible.
Yeah.
Literally, right before my call, Bonnie face, somebody says, coach, it's like 7 o'clock.
Yeah.
What are we supposed to do? I grab my phone and I say, fuck the blackout. I'm back in. I lost $100,000 a day fucking with this blackout. It's go time. Let's go. And I posted it.
Yeah.
Man, I got off that live. Listen, this is real talk. What happened? Yeah. I hate you. I hope you die. We're going to kill you if we ever see you.
Yeah.
People started, okay, my house was getting remodeled.
Yeah.
So I had to move to an Airbnb in Western. I moved it to a furnished Airbnb. It wasn't in a gated community.
Yeah.
You know, Western is one of the richest populations, so it's not gated. Man, let me tell you something. I don't know how people found my address.
What?
People was riding by my house, throwing stuff, screaming out the windows. I couldn't walk. I had to go get AKs for everybody in my house.
Yeah.
My daughter had an AK. My dad had an AK. I had an AK. My sister had an AK. We was petrified. People would come on our lives. Listen to this. Wow. And they'll be tagging. They'll be posting my address. I know where you live. And they'll put my address.
Because of the blackout.
What? Listen. People would. I was going through my messages. Listen. And people would be like, I love you so much. You changed my life.
Yeah.
Then after that video, I hate you, bitch. I hope you die. You're so insensitive. You think you this. The same person that just told me I changed their life if it wasn't for you.
Yeah.
And then I remember looking at my Instagram, and I never seen nothing like this before in my life. I literally watched the unfollow. I saw my followers go from, like, at the time I had like 600,000 followers.
Yeah.
And I watched it go, like, in a matter of seconds down to 250,000. Wow. From a half a million to 250 in like a second.
Yeah.
My team was petrified.
Yeah.
Then my owner of the company that I'm in, we're in this bubble.
Yeah.
This was when you couldn't say all lives matters, only black lives matters.
Yeah.
The next morning, he's doing a broadcast. Yeah, I think, you know, all lives matters.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, now it does. Yeah. But at the time, all lives, Asian people ain't matter. White people ain't matter. Indian people ain't matter.
Yeah.
Haitian people ain't matter.
Yeah.
Norwegian people ain't matter. Black lives matters.
Yeah.
Oh my God, why he did that? She the house nigga working for the white man. She's this, there. She's racist. She's a house nigga. That's what she, it was crazy. My company lost a lot of business. A lot of business. I literally had to hire a full-time security from the threats that I was getting. Like, real talk, it was one of the most horrific things I had ever experienced.
Wow.
I literally couldn't get out of my bed. I couldn't take a shower. I couldn't brush my teeth. I couldn't eat. That's when I realized how much I needed to work on myself. But at the time, that's not what I identified it as. At the time, I felt hurt. Like, as much as I give to y'all people, as much as I'm on live, as much as I'm sowing and serving. And, and
but why do you give them so much energy? Nothing can affect me.
So,
like, I don't get, like, if something happens, like me, I'm not the type of person, I'm not very emotional like that towards, like, social media.
So that was back in 2019.
Yeah.
I don't give a fuck right now.
Okay.
I needed to go. I needed that though. It's like, oops, I needed that.
Yeah.
No, I needed that. Now, I don't care. Yeah. I don't care if you like me. Listen, I don't care if you like me or you don't like me. Yeah. I don't care either way.
Yeah.
But I had to go through that to get to this.
Yeah.
So thank God I didn't quit. I took a vacation. I was off of social media for 40 days and 40 nights. And let me tell you something that I learned. I just was talking about this today. Everybody is dealing with some level of trauma.
Yeah.
You too, me too, everybody.
Yeah.
But depending on who you are and where you are in your life, you understand how to manage your trauma, how to manage your insecurities, how to manage your emotions, how to you know, respect other people's perspectives.
Yeah.
And so now I understand that I gotta respect other people's perspectives, but it don't matter to me. Yeah. What you think is none of my business. I'm not validated or, you know, concerned about what people think about me.
I think when you start really letting people get into your bubble and stuff like that, and you start actually caring, like me, the people I care about is my team, my customers. That's it. If other than that, it's like, what does that matter? You know, so I think like a lot of people, when it gets to the social media thing, people put so much energy building audiences and stuff like that. And then when people start talking stuff about them, they get so emotional and they start trying to protect to not lose that audience. The audience is billions of people in the world.
Right.
You can never lose an audience. You can always grow a new one any day.
It takes growth, though. It takes knowing who you are. It takes respecting who you are.
Yeah.
It takes embracing who you are. And I believe that there had to be something that you experienced that got you to become this Boniface.
Yeah.
So I had to have that experience. It's like, you know, it had to happen.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because that's why I'm who I am today. If I wouldn't have had that experience when I did the low vibrational plate thing, remember that?
Yeah, I never actually seen that.
Right.
Until today. But I seen it, but I didn't know what the whole purpose of it was about. You know, until today. But what you said wasn't kind of wrong. Like, I didn't think it was wrong. People try to mislead what you were saying, you know? And I think that was kind of wrong that they try to mislead what you were saying about her having a whole bunch of food on her plate instead of her having minimal food. And I think that's really good for health too.
So, you know, here's another thing I learned, right? You have to understand the context of why a person says or does what they do. So it's like, okay, you and your woman go through something, right?
Yeah.
And you ask your homeboy, what does he think? But all you could tell him is the story from your perspective.
Yeah.
You and your business partner have a situation.
Yeah.
When you're telling them about the experience, all you could do is tell them from your perspective.
Yeah.
But if a person doesn't understand the full spectrum of what happened, they really should not be giving an opinion.
Yeah.
You really shouldn't be asking them their advice because they don't know the whole story.
Yeah.
So it was deeper than what the internet saw.
Yeah.
I am her coach. I am her mentor.
Yeah.
She had gained about 15 pounds. That was, the camera didn't see that was her second plate.
Yeah.
In like 10 minutes.
Yeah.
The camera didn't know that I was at a woman's retreat, that people were there and paid 10 grand to be there to learn from us, the millionaires. Yeah. And she had a plate that looked low vibrational.
Yeah.
So it's just now, again, I was ready for it.
Yeah.
It was funny. All the hate mail and all the, how dare you do her like that? And that's wrong. Who you think you is? And, you know, your plate was the same thing and whatever. Ha ha ha.
Yeah.
But I was prepared for it because it happened to me before. You understand?
Yeah.
So it's just people didn't understand the backstory. And the backstory is what would have gave more understanding to why that happened.
Well, you know, people on social media always just want to hate on people.
Yeah.
So if they found any, it can be the smallest thing and it would make it, take it so much out of context.
Exactly.
And that's how even like Andrew Tate, he used to say a lot of great things, but people like literally made him look bad.
Exactly.
You know, so it's like when you have a brand, people will want to be able to see if they can take control of your brand.
That's
and
okay.
If you let them,
and they will.
They will.
Yeah.
But if you don't let them, they won't.
Life goes on.
Exactly.
Guess what? Those followers came back.
Yep.
Those followers brought me more followers.
Yep.
A lot of them apologized to me. I could scroll up to 2020, whatever year that was that happened, and see the hate mail again, and then they love me again. And so it's like, all right, I get it now.
Yeah.
And it's okay. Either way it go, good or bad, it's okay.
Yeah, it's always okay.
It's okay.
So now I want to ask you a question, because you said something about you've been spending crazy. Like you spending, how much you spend just on jewelry insurance a month?
$10,000 a month.
$10,000
on jewelry insurance.
Wow.
That's crazy.
That's crazy.
I didn't know that till today. That's why I'm going back home.
Yeah.
To go through all my subscriptions.
Yeah.
And my, what is it called? My auto pays.
Yeah.
And find out what the hell am I paying for? Yeah. I didn't realize, I thought I was only paying like $7,000. I think that's too much.
Yeah.
But I learned today I was paying $10,000 for 5 years with State Farm for jewelry insurance. That's just stupid.
Yeah.
I don't even care about the jewelry. I'm over jewelry.
Yeah.
I only put this on because I know I was coming to see you.
Yeah.
I don't care about this jewelry.
Yeah.
So, like, yes, it's like certain things become waste. You know, when you make a lot of money.
Yeah.
Me personally, coming from the world I come from, I come from the world where I used to do things, yeah. unethical things back yeah. in the day. So even though I'm past that, I would never do anything to take from anybody.
Yeah.
In my mind, when I see $5 million in the bank,
yeah.
I'm like, oh no, that's too much millions.
Yeah.
It's only insured, FDIC insured up to $250,000. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let me invest it somewhere. You know, that's why I invested $5 million with Grant Cardone.
Wow.
I'm like, I got to do something with it. So yeah. it was a lot of things that I was doing for write-offs.
Yeah.
You know, and just unnecessary stuff. But yeah, my jewelry, when I leave you, I'm going to put my stuff in a safe deposit box.
Yeah.
And I'm about to minimize. I don't need all of this. It's unnecessary. I'm over it.
Nice. As an entrepreneur, right, what happens is like, when you make a lot of money like us, you tend to do investments that don't go right. What are some investments that you did? I remember, I would give you, but you go ahead. What are some investments that you did that went, like, it didn't go the way that you wanted, but you didn't let it affect you?
I'll give you one. I invested into the crypto Traders Domain.
Oh, wow.
You know about that?
When I came from, so the whole thing, I came from overseas, right? So me and my family have businesses in Africa.
Okay.
So I was in Africa, and I heard these guys were just doing this trading thing where they're making like $4 million a month or something like that.
A day.
Like Marcus.
Try a day.
And a whole bunch of other guys.
Yeah.
A day. So I'm like, what is this trading thing about? So but when I came back, I was going to invest too. But luckily, I came back. And when the time I came back, everybody was like, no, don't do that.
Wow. So I've been in that trading platform for like 5 years. It was going well.
Wow.
Like, I'm serious. Like, it was going well. There was no indication of any, you know, issues.
Yeah.
But again, everything is good until it's not good.
Yeah.
And so I was able to make my initial investment back, thank God.
Yeah.
But I know a lot of people that quit their jobs, pull out their 401ks. I know a lot of people that sold their houses and was living off of it, and they don't have anything to fall back on. Like, I was able to look up and say, okay, I literally thought I had $50 million in this account.
Wow.
Imagine, come on now, right? We both go-getters, we workers, we gonna work.
Of course.
But if you know you got $50 million just sitting somewhere,
yeah.
you working different. You're like, all right, whatever. I'll talk to you later.
Yeah.
You know, I'll do that later. Like, I got $50 million, my house paid off, I'm good. I'm already making, you know, $400,000 a month. Plus, I got $50 million in a trading account. So imagine waking up one day and finding out that something is wrong.
Yeah.
You requested to pull your money. It's been almost 2 years since I put in a request, and I haven't gotten
How much do they still have for you?
I'm supposed to have $50 million.
Wow.
I could log in and see $50 million.
Wow.
But can I get it? No, it's like Monopoly. It's
How
like
much did you invest in that company?
I invested $1.5 million.
Okay,
I invested $1.5 million, but I got my $1.5 million out.
Okay, cool.
I did, but when I say an investment that I regret, I lost a lot of time thinking I had $50
million. Yeah,
I really did.
Exactly. People don't realize when you make investments and you're thinking about the investments, it takes so much time off of you working on your current projects.
Exactly.
You know, I did an investment. I spent over $1 million, and it didn't go my way. And that's why I just started really started going back heavy on social media.
Oh, so you did that too?
No, not with trading.
No, I'm saying you thought you had some money too.
Yeah, now with traders.
But with something else, okay.
Something else. And I was like so in my whole
You know
what,
you did disappear. I haven't seen you.
I disappeared.
Because you're chilling. Media.
You get what I'm saying? So everything, I was like, what the hell? What's going on? And ended up finding out that it didn't go the way.
Wow.
And now my whole thinking was on that.
Yes.
You know? And
yes.
It slowed me down for so long because I made that investment. I was like, okay.
I'm good. Then you're not good.
And you're not good.
But thank God, people like you and I, we have something that we're good at. We're great at. And it's big. The biggest podcast.
You're the biggest podcast in the world.
We get to get back to work. So I would have to say that was one of my worst investments that I wish I didn't make. And it's because not just the money, because I made my money back, but I lost a lot of time.
Yeah.
And I feel like there's a lot of people that got into it because they heard I was in it.
Yeah.
And I gave that scam credibility. Now, here's the thing.
Yeah.
They're saying that we're going to get our money. They're still saying we're going to get our money. But I better not depend on it, because the light's going to be turned off.
Don't depend on it. Don't depend on it.
So, yeah, I'm not depending on it. I'm back focused. I'm in my bag right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's all about focusing on the future.
That's right.
You know, like now, like, so that was one of the investments. How have you done like real estate stuff? Like, what are some things that you're diversifying in? Because a lot of entrepreneurs, they don't diversify. You know, one thing that I do that really helps me, every business that I have, that I don't run those businesses. I find great people and have them run those businesses for me. Like, that's, I have great. A trucking business. I have some other things going on, but I'm not the one doing it on a daily basis.
That's good. That's great.
So, like, when you're diversifying, what are some strategies that you do?
So, right now, one of my greatest investments, quite the contrary to what people may think, like, I invested $5 million with Grant Cardone.
Okay.
My passive income is like, it's not the percentage that most people would think that I should get.
Yeah.
But my money is secure. It's in a building. I collect like $25,000-$30,000 a month off of it.
Yeah.
My office is actually in that building.
Nice.
Majority of that money goes back to my rent.
Yeah.
However, I know that when Grant sells that building, that's going to be a big payday.
Yeah.
So in the back of my mind, I'm not waiting for it.
Yeah.
But I know it's going to be a day where it's going to be like, hey, partner, we refinanced the building. The bank is a bank, actually. We refinanced. Come get you $8-$10 million.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So that was one of my best investments. But, you know, one of my best investments is investing in people.
Yeah.
I get my biggest return when I invest with the right people.
Yeah.
So I'm very particular now with who I spend my time with.
Yeah.
Because wasted time is worse than wasted money.
For real.
So that's why I love multi-level marketing, because I get to find the right people and invest my knowledge, my understanding, and being their mentor, and that pays me the greatest return. So I've diversified in real estate. I have that building.
Nice.
I have a skincare line that is not doing that great.
You're not focused on it, that's why.
I'm not focused on it.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. It's amazing products. It's not white label. It's amazing proprietary products.
Nice.
But I have a skincare line. It used to do very well. We used to do multiple six figures a month.
Yeah.
But if you're not focused on it and you have nobody to run it,
yeah,
it dies.
Yep.
I bought my yacht. My yacht for me is a great.
What type of yacht you got?
I have a 55-foot Azimut.
Nice.
Y'all got to go on it. It's sexy.
Let's do it.
Yeah, we got to go on it one day.
Let's
it's
do
so
it.
Sexy. We was on it last night. It's super sexy. The
Let's
perfect storm. That's that. You know, it's not cheap to manage it, because I pay every month for parking and management and all that. But it's great for my tax write offs. It's great for my experiences, and it's something that I could say I put money into. That if I was to want to focus on it more and rent it out, I could. But that's just not my priority. So right now, my diversity is really just that makes me feel real good in real estate with Grant. That's my best investment. Yeah.
So a lot of people, the thing about these, a lot of people, right, is that they don't invest in mentorship.
Oh, yeah.
And you're heavily on that. You know, I probably spent like on mentorship probably over $500,000.
Yeah.
Just in my whole business career. I know you spent just with one person, 200. How much you spent on mentorship?
So I've spent millions of dollars. I was a Tony Robbins platinum partner.
Yeah.
I mean, I could tell you one day I invested $200,000 with different on different tools I bought from Grant Cardone and the 10X family.
Yeah.
So millions of dollars. Like, I believe if you want to earn $1 million, you got to find a way to earn, to invest 10% of that into your mind.
Yeah.
Everything for me is mentorship. Everything. I mean, mentors and coaches is the shortcut to success.
Yep.
You want to learn something, go find somebody that's done it and pay them.
Yep.
You earn your way, you pay your way, or you serve your way into good relationships.
And that's true. A lot of people, the thing about it, they don't really like, when it comes to mentorship, they think like, oh, if I invest and learn from other people, that's wrong. But I don't think that's wrong. You should always be willing to want to invest and work with other people.
Again, I think that's a cultural thing. I think that we're not used to that in our community.
Yeah.
Our parents, my mom didn't have a mentor.
Yeah.
My dad didn't have a mentor. They didn't go to seminars and workshops. So it's like they just went to church and paid the pastor and tithe and offering. You know, so hearing somebody say that they're going to put $100,000 into their mind, it's like, what? You about to get robbed.
Yeah.
Go buy a house with that.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I think that's where we come into place. We have to advocate for it, and we got to speak our truth. Like, I became who I am today because I had a good mentor that that cracked me. Like, hey, you can't do that. You can't do that. You should do this. And another thing I could tell you that I've observed, that's why I'm super excited about my newfound reality.
Yeah.
Some people are not ready to be mentored.
Yeah, that's
so they don't want to pay because they're not ready to take the wisdom that they paid for and apply it. So what's the purpose of getting a mentor?
Yeah.
So it's just, you know, we just got to continue putting our energy out there and the right people for me, but they're going to come. You ask me.
That's true. They're always going to come. So Stormy, what's some things that people have never asked you on a podcast?
You know, I just got this, had this interview the other day. This girl asked me some stuff that nobody never asked me. So I don't think I have anything that nobody never asked me. I think if I had to think deep about what is it that somebody never asked me. What's my biggest insecurity, maybe?
Yeah, what is your biggest insecurities?
One of my biggest insecurities, I would say, keeping the wrong people around me for too long because I have a big heart.
Wow.
And I want to see the best in everybody, and I feel like I bring so much value that if a person is not doing what they need to do, just give them a chance, they'll get better.
Yeah.
And every time I say that to myself, I end up wishing I would have got rid of them when I first had that thought of them.
Yeah.
So my biggest insecurity is like, do the people around me have the capacity to think on the level that I think?
Yeah.
And a lot of times they don't. And when I start saying that, I really need to start looking because that means they don't.
Yeah.
And then I can't tell you that I had that feeling about somebody and they got better.
Yeah.
I think I got it from Grant. Most people quit in their head before they quit in reality.
That's true.
So they'll keep getting the paycheck even though they quit.
Yeah.
You just got to recognize when they quit and get rid of them.
That's true.
So I'm kind of like there now. Like, I love you. I like you. But I don't know how you feel about my vision.
Yeah.
I don't know if our visions are aligned. And that brings me to this. You know, like, I wrote this book.
Yeah.
I'm going to give this to you. All these books to you. This book, you're welcome. I was in some really rough relationships. And one in particular, and I woke up one day and said, I got to get out of it. It was like, why am I here 5 years in? And I'm not growing.
Yeah.
One of my philosophies is that progress is the key to happiness and the glue that makes happiness stick. So if we're not progressing together, we can't be together.
Yeah.
And so I literally wrote this book in like an hour.
Yeah.
And it's the new rules that I have to live by in order to elevate, to progress.
Yeah.
And so this is like 20 new rules. And this is a pocket-sized book. Like, I tell people, go, like, turn to a random page. Think about something that you've been thinking about and turn to a random page. It's going to give you an answer.
Oh, no more doubting myself.
Wow. Boom. So.
That's,
so.
That's insane.
Somewhere in your mind, you bony face, but it just spoke to you. It's something that you got to know that you body face.
Yeah.
And this is the biggest podcast in the world.
The biggest.
So that's when I wrote that book. This is my memoir.
Yeah.
This is my memoir. I wrote this book like 11 years ago.
Yeah.
This is like my life story. This is me talking about my mom about to have an abortion with me. My mom was actually interviewed in this book, so you hear her voice. I was in foster care.
Wow.
I dropped out of school in the ninth grade. I used to be a stripper. My first time in a strip club, I was 13. My water was off at home. I had to get some money to turn the water back on. Like, you know, I've been through some things. So I wrote, this is like my memoir up until the age of about 30 in this book. This book is because I've been the number one recruiter in network marketing since like 2016. Like, wow. I recruited 10,000 personal people in my business.
Yeah.
And so I give you all of the strategies and the tips as to how I became the number one recruiter.
Wow.
So this is because, again, people needed to know what to do. My team is so big, I can't talk to everybody one-on-one.
Yeah.
But if you want to know my mind, pick up this book. So that's why I wrote this in like 2016. And this.
Nine laws
of success. My mom died August 26, 2011. I fell into a real bad depression. I went from being a big deal. I went from being on billboards, buses, and that girl driving around in my Bentley to fat, broke, depressed, and unhappily married.
Yeah.
And I had to pull myself out of that darkness. And so all of the things that I did to go from fat, depressed, broke, I have the seven pillars and the nine laws.
Yeah.
And so this is teaching you how to attract health, love, success, and happiness in your life. And so this is from my own experience, what I had to do to pull myself out. So every book that I write is a tool to help you to get into your life, get out of your head and get into your life. And so I put it in paper because I can't talk to everybody individually.
Yeah.
So if you want the information, go buy the books.
And we'll have it down below as well.
Perfect.
So do you have any courses and trainings and stuff that people can be able to tap into your knowledge?
Yeah, so the number one thing I'm proud of that I have a girl community. It's a men in a community, but I have a community called Girl Hold My Hand. Mm-hmm. We meet live every Monday through Friday at 8 a.m. We meditate. I give them messages. I teach them. We have 2 1-hour coaching sessions once a month. I charge them $69 a month to have access to the community.
Nice.
A couple, several hundred women, maybe 400 or 500 women in the community.
Nice.
We've been established since 2018.
Nice.
Girl Hold My Hand. We do trips. I had my awakening event here in Fort Lauderdale just September of this year. $1 million event. You know, I've been doing these for 10 years. I did my last one in September.
Yeah.
So I do live stuff, and then I have a course where I'm teaching you, you know, how to master network marketing.
Yeah.
And that's just the network marketing masterclass, but it's more older, seasoned stuff. For people that really want to know, what did I do at the basics when I first started, before I became Stormy?
Yeah.
Here's all of the foundational things I did to become Stormy.
How did they get access to these, to them?
So, Coach Stormy on Instagram. You just reminded me. I don't even have that link in my Instagram bio. I'm thinking like, oh my God. So everything is in my Instagram, the link in my bio.
Okay, awesome. So how did these people get in contact with you? With Coach Stormy, right? On
the best
all platform?
Thing, Coach Stormy on Instagram. That's it. I'm Instagram is where I made my millions. So I'm always on Instagram. I may not be on TikTok and Snapchat and Facebook, but that's me. I'm really on Instagram.
And you're just getting started.
And I'm just getting started.
You're about to do $1 billion.
Thank you. I am.
And you will.
Come on. I feel that. That's one of my goals. And I feel it. I feel like I'm going to add so much value.
Yeah.
The money not going to have a choice but to show up.
Exactly.
Yep.
Exactly. So what's your 5 secrets to success?
Riches, respect. I respect myself, I respect others.
Yeah.
The I stands for integrity. I believe in doing business with integrity.
Yeah.
Even when nobody looking, I have integrity.
Yeah.
Character. Character will take you where hustling can't.
Yeah.
The H is honor. Your life is a manifestation, and one day will be the manifestation of those you choose to honor and those you choose to dishonor.
Yeah.
When you see somebody struggling, you got to check their respect, integrity, character, honor, and the S is serve.
Yeah.
Riches. You have to always serve.
Yeah.
Never get so down or up on yourself that you forget that there are people that would die to have the life that you now live. That's people true. That need you to show up for them, because as you show up, you're teaching them how to grow up.
That's true. Guys, make sure you like and subscribe to the YouTube channel, and also leave a comment down below what you thought about this episode, and we'll see you on the next one.
Let's go!